There wasn't even enough rain to get the dust off the leaves here. See, that's like going in and saying, yeah, I already heard it. I know the words. Okay, that's all enough. That's like not even enough rain to get the dust off the leaves. Have to have more rain than that. We can't say, oh, it rained here. It rained here. No, it didn't really rain here today. Everything is still dusty as it was before. So you have to have a real rain if you want to wash away the dust of delusion. You have to have a real rain. You have to let it rain. You know, so what we're doing here is we're letting it rain. The cloud, let the rain come down. It's got to come down. And of course, then it's a different situation. You realize, wow, it's raining every so often. Wow. Rather than just keeping it dry and saying, oh, yeah, I know the words. I've heard those words before. All this one eternal life always. Yeah, I got that. I got that phrase in my memory bank. Okay, so what's next? There's no rain there. Everything stays dry. Everything stays drought stricken. Maybe California's chickens are coming home to roost, you know. Maybe it's showing up in a certain way here, isn't it? Possible. Everybody here is so superficially hip. Yeah, I say, we don't need any rain. We don't need any experience of truth. We know the words. We're hip. We're superficially hip. We may need the rest of the world to start praying for California, I'm telling you. The drought here is severe and will have drastic consequences if it isn't, you know, truly broken and the rain actually comes. It's like someone running up a massive bill on their credit card. And they keep getting new credit cards to pay for the bills that they have on the other credit cards. It's like that. This is the condition that California's in as far as the drought goes. We already got people having to use bottled water to take showers. They need to get a bottle of water and they have to import the water from some other state. You know, truck the water in and they take showers with sprinkling water on their bottled water. But we can have a gentle rain. You know, gentle rain. That rain doesn't have to be extreme, you know. But first you start out a little bit, and then gentle rain, get more and more used to it. Eventually you can have a downpour, and it won't bother you. It'll certainly get your attention. I mean, if there's some kind of thunderstorm downpour, you know, that's a attention getter, right? But if you're used to it, it's no big deal. So here, when we say all is one eternal life always, it's like a downpour, thunderstorm. Just trying to stay with it. So this is monastic life, so this monastic culture. Monastic culture is triggering the truth, and then feeling it and staying with it. That's it. That's all it is. So if you can do that and say, yeah, I like this, well, monastic culture is for you then, for sure. I mean, it's an overall, general sense. you see someone just sitting quietly, you assume that they've had the truth. The truth has been triggered, or they're working on it. Everyone's either working on it or having it. That's already happened, and now they're sitting quietly, and just let them sit calmly and quietly because they've been staggered by letting it calming down from it. California's changed drastically. And one of the ways you notice is everybody's walking dogs. You see so many people that go out. A huge percentage of people who walk are walking with dogs. And dogs provide a great excuse for distraction, actually. They're able to keep things very superficial. You meet somebody, oh, look at your dog. And then the dog's, oh, stay down. Wait, come here. Wait, sit. Ah, and so all conversations about the dog and its antics, you know, and it keeps it very superficial. Oh, how long have you had your dog? And it says, chit-chat. And, oh, the dog wants to go now, you know. It says, okay, you see. So the animal nature, everybody has their animal nature, make sure that the animal nature is, the question is, who's on the leash, actually? See, when I see people walking their dogs, who's on the leash? Is the dog on the leash or is the human on the leash? Is the human walking the dog or is the dog walking the human? Is the question. Now you can have pets and animals, and I have many. Most of my life I've had many. But now I don't. But you have to be very, very careful. Very, very careful when you have animals in your life. Very careful. They can be helpful. They can be a source of comfort. Yes, that is very possible. They can be a friend, help calm you down. So there's some positive. But they can also be used in a way that is very distracting. Double-edged sword. In master culture, you don't see people walking their dogs, okay? You don't see people walking their dogs like that. When you go out, you're greeting people. It's for the purpose of, you know, blessings to you. If you have a talk, you may sit and remind one, how's the path today? Have you gotten into, you know, the depth of your path today, and if you had some triggers today of truth, well, how good you? How about you? If you have, you know, conversation needs to be like that. You know, what have you really, you know, remind one another? Have you really put everything into today to evaporate continuity fear today? And you may something may come up and quiet. You're quiet, no distraction. You can just maybe sit there or stand there maybe for half an hour without, you know, no sound, no disturbance. Maybe you got your dog there, say, oh, Fido wants to go over here. Oh, Fido sees another dog. Oh, rah, rah. Oh, look at that. Way, you know. Super distraction. You don't see people bringing their pets into church, but I guarantee you that's the next thing. In California, maybe that's the trend. California's gonna start saying pet-friendly churches. You know, I love my cat. You know, incarnation of bliss. I'm not gonna bring my cat into church. You see, but I bet you in California, pretty soon, if not already, there will be dog-friendly churches. Bring your dog to church. God welcomes all dogs in church. Bring your dog to church. Setting a new trend, and this will sweep the world. Oh yeah, that's what we need. And then people who don't allow their dogs in church are cruelty to animals, discriminatory, exclusive. Need to integrate the church with more dogs, bring the dogs in. prejudiced, bigoted, intolerant, archaic, out of fashion, out of style, stupid, ignorant, mean. So this is what will happen. This is how it goes, right? When you have, you know, toddlers with their little rattles running things in the world, other than their little tree fort, this is how it goes. Already, people here are bringing their dogs into all the businesses. I mean, I'm in a store, and this dog suddenly comes in slobbering all over me, jumping on me and stuff, and it's like nobody says anything. It's like, what are you doing? Well, I can't leave my dog in my car. I have to take it with me wherever I go. It's cruel to leave your dog in the car. Well, then don't bring it with you. Well, I have to bring it with me. I need to, you know. There's all these excuses. It's like the dogs are running the planet instead of God running the planet. As they say, dog is God spelled backwards. Running the show here is that the humans are the animals, you know, and what we're going into is called Animal Planet, actually, where we're just human animals and we're not as savvy as how to be an animal as the dog, so they're just training us how to become better animals. So who's training the dog? We're training the dog, or is the dog training us, is the question. Are we training the dog to be a better human, or is the dog training us to be a better animal? See, human animal. And in my experience, that's what it is. When I'm around pets and animals, I find that I became more like an animal. Absolutely. Human animal. And the spiritual quotient evaporated. Very bad, actually. You become what you hang around with. It's a very strong tendency. So if you hang around with animals, you'll become that way, like an animal. Which means you believe in determinacy and time, space, process, form. And you will not realize that all is one eternal life, always. So in monastic culture, you don't see people bringing their pets or animals, most don't even have any, actually. You don't see them walking their dogs in a monastic community, no. You don't see animals running wild so much. I mean, there can be some presence if it's a situation like that. Like Ramana Maharshi's ashram, there was like a cow, and cows are sacred animals there, and that's understood. There's a peacock there, etc. But that's in the cultural context of the situation. It's a little different. I know people point out those with discrepancies, blah, blah, blah. No, but that's getting outsmarting yourself. So don't outsmart yourself. Dogs being brought to church, that's the next thing, isn't it? For sure. Oh, it's only a little chihuahua I have in my purse here. It's okay, you know. Everyone won't say anything. Oh, dog's just expressing its feelings. Okay. No problem. They're super. How advanced we are. So humans are trying to become animals. They say, we're getting even more advanced at being human animals here. Great progress we're making. So we should be humans. This condition, situation, is realization of there is no condition. There is no situation or condition. We're spirit. So our responsibility is to realize we are spirit. We're formless. In fact, not only are we formless, that there's no such thing as form. Not only that, is there can never be any such thing as form. Again, so it's not like we are spirit and then there's form. So saying we're formless suggests a duality, but there's no possibility of form ever existing. Everything is spirit. All is just one eternal life, always. There's only the one eternal life, and it's spiritual. It's spirit. This is what we're supposed to be realizing here. Now, I know there are all sorts of people teaching dogs to meditate. They say, oh, yeah, the dog is a very good meditator. Yeah. Yeah. Training yoga for dogs. Yoga for pets. But we here, we are realizing all is one eternal life. Always completely spiritual. No such thing as form. It's not that we got rid of form, and it's not that we're preventing form from taking place. Inherently, form can never arise. Inherently, form is impossible. There's nothing we have to do to prevent it or avoid it. It's already the way that it is. Nothing we need to do to prevent it or avoid it. So we don't need to do anything for it to be so. It is so. It is so. It is so. It is so. Now, what kind of results are we getting here? Familiarity. That's the results we're getting. Familiarity, comfort, familiarity with this. We're comfortable. We're familiar. Which means we can go further from this base and get any and experience it. So, the results we're getting are this familiarity. Normalizing it for ourselves, normalizing it. So pragmatically, those are the results that we want. And eventually, pragmatism yields to experiencing. So we have this virulently non-monastic culture of distraction right now in the world. In my entire life where I've lived, I've never had one instance of ever meeting with anybody in any situation where people responded in an appropriate way as far as just letting the moment, letting the moment be. Never. Not even one instance of it. You're right. It certainly seems that way. Certainly seems that way. Arrested development here. Very arrested development. Totally abnormal. But again, we live in a world where abnormality is being worshipped, right? The more abnormal you can look, the more people say, wow, okay. We're making a god out of abnormality, out of bizarre weirdness. But we have a much better goal than that. At least in church, we people, you know, blessing you. Peace be unto you. We say this time for everybody. We greet everybody. Peace be unto you. Peace be unto you. Peace be unto you. Look them in the eye and wish them peace upon you. Peace upon you. That's a little thing, you know, but that's, you know, that's just a little tiny daze, but certainly that's a different way of relating, right? So we try to keep the relating is. Now, some people after church, blah, 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 you know, socializing, oh, how's your kid? Yeah. And others just remain silent, and I just remain silent, don't say anything to everybody, just, because you're supposed to have an epiphany, try to have an epiphany. Of course, in Catholic Church, if you take the Eucharist, which I don't, but if you do, you're supposed to be, you know, transformed, you're supposed to have, be staggered by what has just happened, so you're supposed to be, of course, silent. You go home and you go silent, and you're in prayer, you're like, wow, this is just completely staggering. This is, in theory, what they say. So you're not supposed to be just blah, 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 blah. Some do that, but most are quiet. It's just an external representation of triggering the truth. The Eucharist triggering the truth. It's just speaking to the thoughts and imaginings of the people in the first phase of the path. So then it's this external prop. You know, it's supposed to trigger a profundity of there is no determinism whatsoever. The body of Christ, blood of Christ, is the immediacy of freedom. So they're saying, well, it's here right now. Yeah. Well it's theoretically, you know, this is correct in a certain way. And then, so it's supposed to bring a profundity upon those. But here we can trigger it much more directly. All is one eternal life, always. Yeah. That's a profound triggering, where in the first phase, having some external thing like a wafer, I'm eating the body and the blood, that kind of eating the body, it's been transformed, is a way to trigger profundity in them. By saying, you are. See, you just a simple step, you are the body of Christ, which is the one eternal life always. The body of Christ is the one eternal, all the body of Christ is all, is one eternal life always. That is the body of Christ. There's only one body. There's only one body. All is that one body. All is the body of eternal life. So all is the body of Christ, absolutely. We are all the body of Christ. There's only one body. So this is a way of saying, you are now, you have just experienced the body of Christ. The Eucharist is supposed to, you know, trigger. So it's a way of triggering it for people. And the Mass builds up to that point where they're, so it's a way of using ritual to trigger this. Now, if you can just trigger it on your own, then that's great. Even better. Try to trigger it during the day, all sorts of ways. That's what I've done. I try to trigger it all the time. Just, what can I? How can I use a situation to trigger the profundity? Yeah. So. So pray for rain in your life, the rain of this wonderful triggering. All is one eternal life always. That's it.